Thank you. Come on, Marina, over here. I just want to commend those who planned this retreat, as well as all of you who are participating. I've been at many retreats. I don't think any quite as warm and invigorating as I found this one to be. And I trust that God will send us away with a renewed vision and passion to serve Him with all of our hearts. I might say just a word about the little booklets. I would like to suggest that you have two of these for husband and wife, if you haven't yet picked up a couple of them. And then, if you get in the habit of using them as a regular, systematic way of praying for revival, alternate paragraphs as you have your devotional time together. Anita and I do that, and it's been richly rewarding to us. Some of you were gracious enough to ask about our center last evening, and I thought you might be interested in having one of the balance beams. In spiritual warfare, there are some important words that the Lord has always forced me to keep before me. There are three of them. The first one is the word balance. The second one is the word balance. And the third one is the word balance. I don't believe there's any area in which we must keep more balance than in spiritual warfare. No area that's any more important, at least, than that. And so, whenever I teach on the subject, and I'm so glad for the theme of this retreat is really focused upon prayer, but also tying it in with spiritual warfare. And of course, when you introduce the subject of spiritual warfare, you just about have to include, I'll move that for you. You just about...
Every time you move,
I saw you dodging back and forth, Barbara. You must try to give balance. And I personally feel that what I taught you yesterday about the flesh is probably the most important thing about spiritual warfare that you can ever study. And I'm convinced that one of the reasons that we are in such a sad and serious condition as believers is because just multitudes of believers don't have a clue about how they overcome their flesh. And they're either going at it through a very legalistic approach, or they just thought it was going to happen, or they're seeking some super spiritual experience. And I think that's one of the things that has come out of the renewed emphasis in the charismatic circles, is that if you have a certain charismatic experience, that you will suddenly be transported beyond the battle with your flesh. Well, we know that's not so. And one of the tragic reasons that so many of God's servants are falling into serious sin is that they have not understood how to deal with their flesh. And that includes those in charismatic circles and non-charismatic circles. Today, the scandal of the cause of Christ is that so many who have been spiritual leaders have fallen into serious sin, have disgraced the cause of Christ, and hurt themselves and their families and their churches in ways far deeper than most of us could ever understand or describe. So I can't quite stress that too much, what we taught you yesterday. The urgency of not only understanding how you overcome your flesh, but practicing it and watching for those occasions when your flesh is beginning to try to rule you. To understand the three steps that I shared with you. The first one is the walk of honesty. Being able to admit to yourself and to God that you know and understand about yourself what God understands. You never try to reform your flesh, but you do try to understand how it works, how it tempts. And we need to just, when we recognize the sin of the flesh beginning to tempt us, that we immediately say, Lord, that old sin nature of mine's at it again, and I know it's wicked enough to take me into a terrible expression of this temptation. The second step is the walk of yes, being able to affirm that it is true, because it is true, that you are dead with the Lord Jesus to the rule and the control of your sin nature. There will not be any of us able to stand at the judgment seat of Christ and say, Lord, that old sin nature was just too strong for me and I couldn't overcome it. And he won't need to say anything because we'll know how wrong we were to think that. Because through the death of Christ, we have been crucified to the rule and the control of our sin nature. And then it's so important that we have that third step, the walk in the
Spirit.
Yes. And not to make it something complicated, but just to recognize the truth that the Spirit of God lives in me. He's waiting for us to invite him to supplant, to replace that temptation that we're feeling in our flesh, in our mind and will and emotions with the fruit of his control. And it's a marvelous experience to do that and to see how victorious the Lord begins to make us. I just received a letter, it's about a week ago, from a man down in Dallas. And I was down there a few months back and taught a men's Bible class. And it was smaller than this group, just on spiritual warfare, and dealt mainly with the subject of the flesh. I didn't have time for more than that. But there was one of the men in that group that apparently had been having a terrible defeat in his life. And he wrote me a letter and said, after I had taught him about his flesh and about the biblical steps to control it, he had hope in his heart. But he didn't say anything to me because he had had hope so many other times that he was going to overcome it and yet had gone back into defeat. But after practicing his steps over the flesh, that I gathered it was in a moral area, though he didn't really say, he wrote me this glowing letter of victory and thanking me for having taught them. So I can't stress that too strongly. It's just vital. But there are times when the problem gets deeper than just our flesh. And I want to take you to the book of Ephesians. For that, we were asked by Lori at the close of the last session, if some anger is not valid. And she's right on target, because there is a holy, righteous anger. One of the proofs of that, of course, is in Mark chapter 3. And let me just read. This is the case of the man with the withered hand. And some of his critics were there just seeing if he would heal on the Sabbath. And verse 5 said, he looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, and said to the man, "Stretch forth your hand." So the Lord Jesus experienced righteous anger. And that's a very noble kind of anger. I wish I had more problem with that kind of anger than I do. Rather, I should say, I wish I had more experience of holy anger than I do. I know that there have been times in my own experience when I've experienced that. We were in a motel. I was sharing this with some of the folk. And we had our grandchildren there. And they were fingering the remote. And all of a sudden, something flashed on the screen that alarmed both Anita and me. We saw it, and we quickly turned it. And I'm thankful we didn't see what could have been shown. Because when we looked at it later, we discovered that this particular hotel was piping pornography into every room. And if you stayed on that channel for more than just a few seconds, you would be automatically charged. But they were piping it into the rooms. And families leaving their children in these rooms. And I confess to you, I felt holy anger. You know, we can be so thankful when God lets us experience some of that. And it's a wonderful thing. But I'm sorry to say that most of the struggle we have with anger is not that kind. And may God encourage us whenever it is. We used anger yesterday as one of the illustrations of the sin of the flesh. For a reason, and that's a social sin. Anger's one of those that erupts in all of our lives, and in some of us, because of our temperament makeup, perhaps more than others. And the reason I wanted to use anger is because of this text in Ephesians 4. We'll start with verse 17. I want you to notice how that anger or rather the sins of the flesh and Satan's work interface. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do. What's he talking about there? As who are the Gentiles? Who do they represent? The non-believers. Believers are not to live as the non-believers do, in the futility of their thinking. Their minds are corrupted. They are darkened. Now that's an important statement, because it has reference to the darkening of Satan's control over them. And Ephesians 2 lets us know that non-believers are ruled by Satan, whether they recognize it or not. And so non-believers are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God. They don't have the Holy Spirit bringing spiritual life into them. They have no resource to overcome their flesh. They are ruled by it and ruled by Satan. And so he says, and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Then he reminds us, they've lost all sensitivity. They've given themselves over to sensuality. Remember, that list of the sins of the flesh began with sensual sins, moral sins. And people who indulge in every kind of impurity have a continual lust for more. And that's true of non-believers and believers. That if you indulge your sinful nature, the only thing you're going to get out of it is a continual lust for more. And you are headed toward bondage. You really are. All right? You, however, did not come to know Christ that way. He's reminding us we're different. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. All victory flows out of truth. We emphasize that. You were taught with regard to your former way of life, this is your flesh, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. Don't let it rule you. To be made new in the attitude of your minds. There's the Christ life again, the life of the Holy Spirit. And to put on the new self, created to be like God, in true righteousness and holiness. That's one of the verses that support my conclusion that this part of us, that spiritual reborn spirit, is as ready to go to be with the Lord as it ever will be. It's created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood. Now he begins to deal with some of those that are very subtle to all of us and speak truthfully to his neighbor. For we're all members of one body. Then here's what we were getting at. In your anger. Now I love the way he puts it here. I think in the King James it says, be angry. And that's an unfortunate translation because it almost says, let her fly once in a while. That's not what it means at all. He's simply recognizing that in the sins of the flesh, you're going to face anger. So he says, in your anger, when you're tempted with anger, do not sin. Handle it, as we were talking yesterday. And then to add to it, he says, do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. Now, the proof of the fact that this is not righteous anger he's talking about is that if it's righteous anger, we ought to go to bed with righteous anger. But here he's talking about fleshly anger. Anger that we have the capacity to let it rule until it becomes bitterness. And then he tells us something very significant. Do not give the devil a foothold. Now, what happens to you and me as Christians when we let a sin, like the sin of anger, rule us? We excuse it. We say, well, that's just the way I am. I've got this problem. And we never really deal with it. We talk it away. Then what happens? We give place. Now we could use this with any one of the sins of the flesh. In fact, the very first person I dealt with in spiritual warfare after the Lord led me into it was a man who had a problem in his moral life. And he was going to commit suicide. If you've read The Adversary, you've read about that experience. And he was under demonic control because he had given in to that sin. And he told me later, he said, you know, when I used to first do that sin, I did it willfully and deliberately because I enjoyed it. But you see, the day came where he didn't enjoy it anymore, and he wanted to be free, but he was in bondage. And he didn't know what to do about his bondage. And I'm sorry to say that he was going to Christian psychiatrists, and he named several of them, and he went to a number of Christian pastors who never really taught him how to deal with demonic control. Now, the warning is that if you give in to a sin of anger, there comes a time, inevitably, when it becomes more than a fleshly sin. It becomes a case of demonic control, demonic rule. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying demonic possession. I think that's extremely poor terminology for Christians to ever use in understanding spiritual warfare. We're talking about rule and control And I'm not concerned about whether it's internalized control or external control. To me, that's not an important issue. I think that Satan's really tried to create a straw man to get Christians discussing and debating whether or not a Christian can have an internalized demon. To me, that's such a futile discussion. And I feel like we ought to stay away from it. The issue is control. The issue is rule by an unclean spirit. And if he happens to be out here someplace and still has ground so he can influence my mind and will and emotions to such a level that using my victory over the flesh doesn't solve it, then he's done his purpose. And demons have that assignment. What assignment do demons have? Well, their major assignment is to harass, defeat, bind up Christians who don't know how to stand in their liberty and victory. So when that happens, you have to take your victory over the flesh to a fourth step. And I'm going to give you just, and I think we need to be very careful when we verbalize our victory over our flesh as well as over Satan. And I like to recommend a resistance prayer like this. Say, for example, you're battling with the fleshly sin of lust. And let me walk you through it. First of all, you say, Lord, that old fleshly nature of mine is at it again. And I know that it's wicked enough. If it's allowed to express itself, I'll be into fantasizing or pornography or whatever expression of lust you're being tempted in. But I affirm in my Lord Jesus that I'm dead to its rule and control. And right now I'm asking the Holy Spirit to supplant and replace that temptation that I'm feeling of my flesh to be lustful with the fruit of his control, so that love and joy and peace and patience, gentleness, faithfulness and self-control begin to flow out of my life. And Lord, you know, I've been giving in to this sin. It's been ruling me for some time. And you might even say, I know it ruled in my family lineage. And I know that there's an unclean spirit of lust trying to rule me. And in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the power of his blood, I come against the wicked, unclean spirit of lust and all of his host. And I command you to cease your wicked work against me, and you must leave me and go where the Lord Jesus Christ sends you. Now that's a biblical resistance based upon doctrinal truth. You have that authority, and we're going to look at it in just a moment. But unless we teach people the basics of how to do it, they're going to be overwhelmed. And we need to help them even with verbalization. And that's one of the reasons I just went through that verbalization. I think that it always, when you resist Satan or resist unclean spirits, the other side of the issue is always yielding yourself to God. Wherever you find the command to resist the devil, you also find the urgency of yielding our total person to the Lord. And so I like to encourage folk to say something like this after they've expressed their resistance. I desire the Spirit of the Lord to rule my mind, my will, my emotions, my body, on the conscious level, the subconscious level, and the unconscious level of my whole person and being, and no unclean spirit to rule me. You see, that's yielding yourself to God again. So I hope that you will find this very practical. Now, we want to move over to the sixth chapter of Ephesians. As I mentioned, there are key chapters where the word deals with each of our enemies. And Ephesians 6 is the key chapter to dealing with Satan. Really, the whole book is a discussion of spiritual warfare and the application of our victory over the world and the flesh and the devil. But this sixth chapter really focuses in on our battle and how to apply our victory, and I want to share that with you. And the assignment of this particular session is really to share about doctrinal praying. And I'm going to teach you right out of this portion how you do that. And by the way, I'd like to request that in that little prayer patterns that you and your mate or you and some other person before tomorrow try to read through number 4, because you'll see how what I'm going to teach you is verbalized in that prayer. And I think it will be helpful to you to teach you more about doctrinal praying. Remember now the three questions we're seeking to ask about each one of these enemies. First of all, a biblical definition. Now, we don't have time to go into an extensive biblical definition of Satan and his kingdom, but it's beautifully set forth in this Ephesians 6 passage. You'll notice that at the close of verse 11, we're reminded that putting on the full armor of God enables us to stand against the devil's schemes. Now, you have to understand something of what you're up against. So in this kingdom of darkness, you have a hierarchy of evil. And at the top of the hierarchy is Satan. And he is behind the battle that we face. Satan is the ruler of the kingdom of darkness. And as much as he's able to keep it under a disciplined control, by the way, it's probable that he has simply taken the kingdom of darkness that fell with him. And according to Revelation 12, it's probably a third of the angels followed Satan in the rebellion. Read that in Revelation 12. And most Bible scholars agree that that's probable. And so here we have devil, the Satan, with subtle scheming working against us. And I want you to see how close it comes to us for our struggle. Now that, in the King James, is wrestling. It's one of the most fatiguing sports that any of us can engage in. And even though you're a part of a team in a wrestling match, you're uniquely alone out there when you wrestle. If you've ever wrestled, even in high school level, you know how terribly fatiguing, how demanding it can be as you pitch yourself against your opponent. And this reminds us that Satan comes very close to you and me, and that the way his schemes come to us is through his kingdom, through those that are a part of his kingdom. Now, I'm going to just illustrate it as the King James puts it. You have levels. If you have, first of all, this princely level. Dr. Fred Dickinson and some others have two levels above this level: thrones and dominions. Personally, I believe Paul gave us a complete list here. And that when he's talking about thrones and dominions, they're all in this princely level. And these are very, very powerful wicked spirits. And they also have an order within them. These would be on the general level of a military organization. And we know we have 5-star generals and 4-star generals and brigadier generals. Well, that's kind of the way it is, as I understand it, in the kingdom of darkness. And we don't know how many there are, but all of these on this command princely level get their orders directly from the commander in chief. And they carry out his orders. Now, they have intelligence of their own, and certainly they use all of their cunning to carry out the will of the commander-in-chief. If they didn't, they'd sure be in trouble with him. And thus you have, in Daniel 10, you have the prince of Persia and the prince of Greece. I remember the first time I prayed against the Prince of America. I'll never forget it. The atmosphere in the church where I was walking and praying just suddenly was electric and took my breath away. I was startled by the opposition that I faced in that encounter. So the princely level is very powerful level. But in the King James, the next level is called rulers, isn't it? Now, we don't know how many there'd be on that level. But the reason I single out one prince is that every prince has an indefinite number on the ruler level under him. And then you have powers, I believe it is, on another level. And once again, you have the same thing. Each one of the rulers has a number of subordinates that answer to him. And then you have the wicked spirit level down at the lowest level. And these are the ones that are carrying out the orders of those above them. Now, the reason I do this is because it's very important to understand something of this scheme of things. Because when you deal with demonic powers, especially if you confront them, invariably what they'll try to do is push out somebody down on this level, and he'll just be obstinate and very difficult to deal with, and finally you may get rid of him. But what you've done, I often use the illustration of a weed. Let me try to draw some sort of picture of a weed. We always know that there's an above the ground exposure of the weed, but anyone who does any kind of gardening knows that below the ground there's this vast network of roots, and these roots spread out. Now, when you go to get rid of the weed, you don't dig down and get a hold of one root and try to pull the root out. No, you want to get a hold of the weed and then be careful that you get the whole root system. And many weeds, if you don't, you leave part of the root system and it rebuilds and regroups. And so it's important, if you ever do confrontation, you want to find the one who's up here. And then you bind his whole kingdom to him. And you don't even need to get the names of these down here. In fact, that's a fruitless sort of procedure. You want to learn who's the culprit that gets his orders directly from Satan, that has this network, this kingdom, and bind his whole kingdom to him and command them to leave and go where the Lord Jesus Christ sends them. So this is a description of who this enemy is and how he's organized and how he's structured, so that the Lord doesn't want us to enter into spiritual warfare against the kingdom of darkness in ignorance. Now, we don't know everything about the kingdom, and we don't want to know. The only thing we want to know is enough so we know how it works, so that if we need to oppose it, we can do it on a biblical understanding. Now, the next question that we need to look at, and I must watch the time because it's getting away here. The next question has to do with, how does this enemy tempt me? And there are so many things to say about this, and I'm not going to deal too extensively with it, other than to just give you some of the major areas in which you can expect him to assault. First of all, he seeks to get us to lie and to believe his lies. He's a deceiver. And he always works on deception. He wants to deceive you, get you to believe the lie, even get you to enter in to thinking that there are times when you need to lie in order to please God and serve God well. And you discussed something of that yesterday, and I'm sorry I had to miss it, because I think it was a very important discussion. Well, Satan is a liar, and he's the author of the lie. When he lies, according to John 8, he speaks his native language. Another way he tempts us is to act independent of the will, the expressed will of God, and tries to get you to doubt God's expressed will. That's exactly the way that he worked in Eve's temptation. He expressed doubt about the revealed will of God, and she fell for it. And whenever we do that, we soon come under his bondage and his control. He seeks to make us afraid of him and of his power. Fear is probably one of the strongest ways in which Satan tempts us. Whenever you find yourself with irrational fear, you can know beyond any question Satan's at work. He seeks to accuse us and destroy our sense of self-worth. And I wish I had time to take Neil Anderson's statements in his book, it's in The Bondage Breaker, but his other book on, somebody help me. Anyway, it's on Victory Over Darkness is the name of it. But in it, he has a tremendous list, I think some 30 statements of who a believer is. And I tell you, you read through that list, and before you get through it, you're shouting hallelujah. It's tremendous, you see, to understand who you are. Well, Satan, he'll do everything he can to deceive you about who you are. He's an accuser. And when you begin to think ill of yourself and put yourself down, and you get your eyes directed away from what the Lord has made you, you're one of God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, as we said yesterday there from Colossians. And when you begin to lose sight of that, the enemy has deceived you and is tempting you. He seeks to get us to desire the power that he can give us. And in that power, he wants us to worship him. That's the whole secret behind the Satanist movement. They're after his power. That's why many of your rock singers and rock composers, they're Satanists. Does he have the power to do that? He sure does. If you doubt that, read again the temptation that he brought against Jesus. He said, you bow down and worship me, I'll give you the kingdoms of the world. He would have had it too. And I was sharing with some, when I was over in Africa the last time, leading African official, number two person in this government, told me that she did not know of a single government in Africa that didn't give credit to the devil for being in power, and that they regularly sacrifice, sometimes even human sacrifices, to Satan to stay in power. It's a fascinating statement. So they do seek his power. Well, we can't stay any longer in that, because the best is yet to come. How do we overcome this kingdom of darkness? You'll notice that this passage begins with that word, finally. He says, finally be strong. Now that word strong is a very strong word. It's an explosive word. It's the word, as many of you know, from which we get our word dynamite. Be explosively strong. That's the will of God for us in our battle with darkness. And I think when you begin to catch view of this, you begin to catch a little understanding of how we ought to be praying. Because of who we are in Christ, it's the will of God that we be explosively strong. I like to use the word invincibly strong. To do the will of God. Not in a presumptuous way, but in a cooperating way with our Heavenly Father. To accomplish His will. There isn't any of us who cannot, no matter if Satan, through himself and all of his third of the fallen angels, against us directly, we can be invincibly strong to do the will of God. Now you better know how that works, because the enemy will do all that he can to dissuade you that that isn't so. And he'll come against you with powerful demonstrations. You know, demons always try to exalt their power. And I don't let them do that anymore. They try to do that, I just say, I subdue you in the name of the Lord Jesus. You cannot show your power. I press you down. I command you to be subdued before the Lord. And they go quiet. We have that authority. Because we are commanded to be strong, to be invincible, to do God's will. And then he tells us how. And this is the whole secret to doctrinal prayer. The first step to being invincibly strong is to understand what it is to be in Christ. The phrase is so short, you almost miss it. Be strong in the Lord. And I read that for years. And I just kind of almost dismissed it as a redundancy, because it appears so often in this book. In fact, I would suggest as an exercise, as a follow-through on this series, you just read through Ephesians, and every time you come to that phrase or its equivalent, mark it. And you'll discover it's there over 40 times in this little book of Ephesians alone. It has everything to do with being strong, to understand what that phrase means. In the Lord is talking about the fact that when you become a Christian, you are united to Jesus Christ. You're united to Him and all of His person and all of His work. And doctrinal praying, other than what we talked about previously of just worshiping our Heavenly Father and appreciating the wonder of who He is, really focuses right at this point of being able to identify with the Lord Jesus in who He is and what He's done. And I like to start with his name. And please try to get in the habit of using his full name. Lord Jesus Christ. And pray that name over your personal life, in your walk with God, over your family, over your ministry, against the devil. It's devastating to the enemy. It's a name above every name. He's Lord, he's Jehovah, he's Jesus, the only Savior. He's Christ, God's anointed prophet who proclaimed the way and is the way. He's God's anointed priest who offered a better sacrifice, and he is the sacrifice. He's God's anointed king who rules in sovereignty right now, even over the kingdom of darkness. It can't even hold together without him. According to Colossians, he's the creator, and in him everything holds together. It's a powerful name. And you can worship the Lord an hour just dwelling on his name and just delighting in it. But this "in the Lord" doesn't stop there. You're in the Lord, you're in his incarnation, his humanity. And it's a wonderful truth that Christ became a human being. And I could teach you out of Ephesians how that his victory over Satan as the creator certainly is there. But then he brings it down to us. And he was deity. In human form, God became a human being. And because he did that, see, that's why Satan hates the incarnation so much. You remember one of the tests of a spirit, according to 1 John 4, is if Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Satan's afraid of that because he knows it means that the victory Christ won over Satan, he did on our level. As a human being, he overcame all of his temptations. He fulfilled all the righteousness of the law. He was worthy, worthy, worthy every day that he lived. Why do you think you're blessed? Because you're so nice? No. He sees you in Jesus. And all that perfect, sinless life that Christ lives. He's your life. And that's why you're worthy before God. You can spend time worshiping him there. I never really knew what it was to worship till God taught me doctrinal praying. And now sometimes I get just lost. I never get beyond in the Lord because it's so beautiful to dwell on his incarnation and then to go on to his cross. And all that happened there to benefit you, to take away your sins, to robe you in righteousness, to destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. And then to dwell upon his resurrection. See, in the triumph of his resurrection, he broke Satan's power over death to hold us in death's bondage. And he brought newness of life to us. And we're able to walk in the Spirit because of the same power that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us. Resurrection power. We're united with the Lord Jesus in his ascension into heaven, in his glorification, in his high priestly ministry. And you can spend a half hour on each one of those. Just talking back to God. And you'll grow, and you'll grow, and you'll grow. And the Word of God will come alive to you. Because that's what it's all about. Every instruction, every discipline the Lord expects of us flows out of our union with Christ. The next phrase that's tremendously important to our victory is the second one in that 10th verse, in his mighty power. Once again, we almost miss it because it's so short. But every word is important. And here he's talking about the Holy Spirit, because any time the power of God being lived out in the life of a believer is mentioned, it has reference to the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit, they had to wait at Jerusalem until they had been endued with power, till the Holy Spirit had come upon them.